got a couple of things. In your long time working with quarterbacks over the years, is there a difference when you get handed a top pick or an undrafted free agent? Are there special challenges and different ways to go about it depending on what kind of quarterback you are handed?
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily. It's based on the round, Paul. It's definitely, you look at the skill set of each player, and each player's a little bit different, and you try to, develop that skill set. Again, it's a little bit harder when it's the third guy rather than the first or the second guy, but we got a big staff, and we work with a bunch of those guys. I'd say Christian Jones has worked with those kind of three quarterbacks, if you will, the assistant quarterback coach. When Kafka and Shea are dealing with the first two guys, I talked to DeVito, once a week. It goes back to training camp. But again, each player, each quarterback is different, has a different skill set. But there's a part of the developmental process that goes along with every position, but particularly that one's pretty important because they don't maybe get as many reps as some of the other guys get at different positions that you can roll in there. So it doesn't really matter the round. It's more focused on the player and then, what does that player do well? And again, it's a little bit harder than some other positions because they don't get as many reps. They get the show team reps and things like that. But, he's done a good job of working with the coaches and trying to improve on a day-to-day basis.
You said you talked to him once a week back in training camp that started. Is that, anybody in that position is the number three quarterback, that's what you would do?
Yeah, he's a rookie player, so we talk about a lot of different things. We meet every Thursday in the morning before everybody kind of gets here, and we go through a variety of different things, situational stuff, basic offensive terminology, different quarterbacks around the league, different types of tapes that show up, whether it's turnover tapes or big play tapes or red zone tapes or decision making tapes, and just a way to get to know the quarterback, who's really, the third guy as a head coach. I think that's important.
Thank you.
Yep.
Bruce back.
Good morning, Brian.
Hey, Bruce.
I asked you about Tommy DeVito before the first preseason game, and while many had doubts, you said, give him a chance, let's see. What qualities did he possess that made you believe that he could succeed if given a chance?
Yeah, well, he did a good job of picking up our offense. I think he operates well in the pocket. He's got quick feet. He throws with anticipation and timing. And he's instinctive. He does a good job of seeing defenders and feeling defenses. I don't think he's an overprocessor, an overthinker. He can make a variety of the throws, and he was a good young player to try to work with and develop, and hopefully that you spend a year with him that he gets a little bit better so that you have something the following year. But things kind of have sped up for him. He's had this opportunity, and look, there's plenty of things that that he knows he needs to work on, and we need to work on with him that we can help him. But he's got the right mindset, the right approach. He's done a good job since he's been here.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep.
Dan Duggan.
Hey, Brian. How does a quarterback develop like pocket presence or pocket awareness?
It's a great question. It's tough. You can do a variety of drills with them, but until you're actually in the line of fire where you can take those shots from 310, 330, or edge rushers, blitzers, I don't think you have a great feel. You evaluate it on college tape, but the good ones that I've been around have a unique way of dealing with, call it the congestion that happens in the pocket. And the different drills, you work on those on a daily basis, but I think it's something innate that they have, that they're able to keep their eyes down the field, stay in the pocket, move a little bit, maybe get out when they have to, an instinctive feel that, the good ones that I've been around have done a good job with that. And he's, I'd say that he's got some good pocket presence. Obviously, we got some stuff to work on. But for a young player, he's willing to stand in there. And, he's has pretty quiet feet, quick feet, but quiet feet when he has to. And the line knows where he's going to be most of the time. And he gets the ball out. You know, he does throw with some good anticipation and timing. So, again, he's only played two games. So, have a tough challenge this week and a lot of things we need to work on.
And one more. Randy's gone through his three elevations. So, what's the kicker plan this week?
Yeah, I'll meet with Joe after these meetings, Joe and the doctors and the rest of the crew, and come up with a plan as to how we're going to, you know, kind of go forward here.
Kim Jones. Hey, Gabes, how are you?
Morning, Kim. How are you?
I have two others for you, but sure. What does it mean that he has quiet feet?
Yeah, when he gets back in the pocket, he doesn't move around a whole bunch. He stays in that pocket, if you will, and he doesn't get moved too far to one side or the other side. He's where he needs to be most of the time, and when he's not there, that's usually for a reason. When he's moving, those first couple games he's played, so be challenged going forward. It is always for young quarterbacks, particularly in this league, that are, you know, getting hit and rushed and things like that from some really good players. But he's done a nice job.
The play I wanted to ask you about was the 36-yard run by Saquon.
Sure.
And I'm just curious what he did right in that play, because it felt like it had, looking back at it, I didn't notice this in real time, but it looked like it had almost layers to it, layers to the play. And and so what did Saquon do right? And maybe as importantly or more importantly, what did those offensive linemen, I think it might have been John Michael, and I'm not sure if the other was Pugh.
Yeah. Yeah, but, I mean, it was really five. The play got started because of Bellinger and Shep. It kind of had a pressure that went inside, but they sealed the edge and prevented the penetration off the pressure. And then Wandell really did a great job of blocking the edge guy. And then we got two linemen out in front, which was a clean look for Saquon. And then, you know, once Saquon got onto the open field, you know, he didn't get touched for a little bit. Then he made, you know, elusive plays, made a guy miss and ran with power and strength. So it was, it was a timely play call by Mike. We hit it into a good look. The guys did a good job of getting the play started. And then Saquon in space it's always a good thing when he's in space.
Do you think a play like that can demoralize a defense?
It was a good play. I'd say you just get ready to play the next play. They did a heck of a job of stopping our running game. I don't want to speak for them, but they were doing a dang good job of stopping our running game, controlling the line of scrimmage. So it was good to get that one. Obviously, gave us a little bit of spark.
And just real quick, do you have a Slayton update?
I don't. No, I will on Wednesday, but I haven't met with those guys yet.
Thank you.
Yep.
Ryan Dunleavy.
Hey, Dave. If you could if you could take me beyond the Giants focus for a sec, I'd appreciate it. Last year, 66 different quarterbacks started games. This year, it's already been 48 different quarterbacks have started games. Is grooming a viable backup quarterback more important than ever now in today's NFL? You've been in the league for 20-plus years, and why do you think that is?
I think it's always been important because you're one play away of having a player have to go in there and compete and play and keep the ship, you know, sailing, so to speak. So I don't know if there's ever been a de-emphasis on it. I think it's always been important. Always been around, you know, guys that have played a little bit and have experience in that role. But if you can find a young player that you can develop and groom into that role, I think that's helpful. But it's a tough position, obviously. It's demanding, it's taxing, it's the most difficult position to play, just whether it's mentally, physically. There's just so many things that go on and so much preparation that each player has to do to be able to play that role. And I always say, you know, having a backup quarterback, you know, you need a guy to be able to go in there 4 to 5 games and be able to keep it going if something happens in that kind of time frame, if you will.
Why do you think that we're seeing so many different quarterbacks? Like I said, 66 was the record last year, going to get challenged this year. Is it because of more attention to injuries, less patience in coaches with their quarterbacks? Like, why do you think the last couple of years we've seen more than ever before?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a great question. I can only speak for us right now. So we're on our third one, and both of them have been a result of injuries. I'm sure there's a lot of I couldn't give you, you know, probably the answer that you're looking for. I could just, you know, speak on, you know, I've been in the league quite some time, and there's been years that I've had three or four play in a season, and then times where just one is played. So usually when you only have one play, there's something going right, you know, and it's going good. And when you have two, three, or four, then, you know, there's different challenges that come up with that. But it's a hard position. It's a hard position to play. You know, it's why it's so important to develop these young players that you have on your roster, whether they're on the practice squad or maybe less experienced. I think that, you know, that's a very important aspect of, you know, coaching offensive football and particularly quarterbacks.
Thank you.
Yep.
Tom Rock.
Brian, I'm sure you haven't done your deep dive or not ready to give it to us yet on the Patriots, but just in general, what's it like coaching up against Bill, and what does it mean for you? You've done it a couple of times as a play caller, I guess. What is it like to go up against him as an offensive coach?
Well, it's got a tremendous amount of respect for one, that organization, Mr. Kraft and Jonathan, Dan, Josh, all those guys, and obviously Bill, you know, gave me my first opportunity in the NFL. So I think, I don't know, this might be 17 or 18, somewhere around there, of times that games that we've played that I've coached, obviously not as a head coach, but whether it's a coordinator or a position coach, you know, got a ton of respect for that team, for that organization, and just really getting started right now on preparation for him. So that answer your question?
Well, what does he normally do that makes it, what makes him so challenging to go up against, I guess, as an offensive play caller, not the play caller, but when you were a play caller, against his defenses?
Well, they're well prepared. You know, he's going to have whatever he wants to have in relative to, it changes week to week. That's the approach that they've had there for a long time. Again, not having been back there, maybe that's changed a little bit. Maybe it's not. I don't want to speak for them, but they're always well prepared, and they have good coaches, good players. You know, the usual stuff.
Thanks.
Yep.
We will take the five hands that are raised, but please limit your questions to one each. Tom Canavan.
Hey, good morning, Brian.
Morning, Tom.
Yesterday was the first time you had the same line together in consecutive games all season. Was there were times when you looked at it, they seemed to struggle with communication. Is it too much to expect these guys only playing together two games in a row to have that?
Yeah, they didn't struggle with communication.
Was it just missed blocks then, or what?
Yeah, there was a couple plays. Again, give Washington credit. They got some two good interior players that do that to a lot of teams. There was, you know, I'd say very few mental errors, some physical things that we can, you know, shore up on. But those guys are good communicators, work well together. Again, this is their second time, but they're true pros. And, you know, again, those interior guys are pretty good players. So our guys battled, competed, wasn't always perfect, not at any position on the team, whether it was offensive line, quarterback, defensive line, D-backs, all of us. So, but those guys care. They work extremely hard, and, you know, they're good guys to have.
Thank you.
Yep.
Art Stapleton.
Hey, Dabes.
Art, how are you doing?
Good. Along the lines of the line, since John Michael has gotten back from his injury and has kind of settled in again, is there anything you could point to in his game that you see now that really you weren't seeing early in the year and that's you know, kind of speaks to his development and growth as a player?
Yeah, I'd just say there's been steady improvement really in every area. Are there plays that, you know, he wishes he's back? Sure, everybody has those plays, particularly the guys that play inside there. But I think it's been good for him to have, you know, Bredesen next to him as a good communicator, and Pugh. And those guys are continuing to, you know, work on, you know, fundamental things that help him. But he's, you know, he's got the right approach. I'd say, you know, each game he plays, he gets more experience. There's different things that he sees that maybe he didn't see, you know, at the college level. Different powers, different sets, different rushes, different looks that he has to communicate. But I'd say his communication has been, you know, steadily improved. He's a smart young player.
Thanks.
Yep.
Charlotte Carroll.
Hey, Dibs. How's it going?
Morning, Charlotte. How are you?
Morning. I know you were asked about Slayton, but were there any other injuries coming out of yesterday?
No, I think we're pretty clean. Just a couple nicks and bruises, but I'll meet with those guys after here. But I think we're pretty clean.
Thanks.
Yep.
Russ Salzburg.
You hear me now?
Got you, Russ. How you doing?
Good. How you doing?
Good.
Listen, obviously. A game like yesterday has to be a big boost for the confidence of, you know, Tommy DeVito. But what about his teammates moving forward? When they see, you know, here's this young guy getting his break and he can have a game like that, what does it do for his teammates' confidence to say, hey, you know what, maybe we're not spinning our wheels here. Maybe we can ascend and,
sure,
and you know, do a lot better than people are giving us credit for or being able to do.
Yeah, I'd say that. You know, again, I think Tommy has got a good personality, and I think he draws a lot of people with him. You know, there's, you know, even the games that, you know, it wasn't the results that we wanted. We're out on a practice field, and, you know, he's making a few throws here or there, and then you see, you know, three D linemen run on the field and high five him. He just has he's got a good personality about him that he knows how to interact with people. And I think those guys have confidence in him, but it's good for them to see him have some success, because I think it, you know, again, the last few weeks that he's been practicing, he's brought an energy to the team, I think, and not just the offensive guys, I say the defensive guys that are, you know, jumping around and, you know, he's out there singing songs and dancing in the huddle and doing some things, and I want him to be himself. You know, everybody's a little bit different, so I think those guys were really more happy for him, of how he played, and they know the type of commitment that he's made to them and to our team of trying to do everything he can do to be as good as he can be for him.
Great, thanks.
You got it.
Last one, Jordan Renan.
Hey, Brian.
Morning, Jordan.
In regards to Saquon in the passing game, how much of his involvement or increased involvement was game plan-wise for that specific game, and why do you think he hasn't been a bigger factor throughout this year? You mentioned that play that you scored a touchdown on. He's been, you know, you guys did it all summer. He's been asking for it to be called.
Yeah, I thought, again, it was a timely call by Mike. We got the exact right look that we had practiced again for the last few weeks. You know, the first third and 10, and he made a nice play on a loose scramble. And then down in the red zone, you know, he's run that a fair amount. It's just a little cross kind of flare type route. So again, they were doing a good job of, you know, two ways you can get them the ball, one in the pass game, one in the run game. So we try to use them the best we can. They were doing a good job of preventing some of these runs breaking out. So it helped to get them the ball in a couple different spots in the pass game.